State lawmakers made some changes to the state's pension system this last session. Some public employee unions, though, think the changes may violate the Constitution, which says, quote, public retirement systems shall not be diminished or impaired. Here to talk about all this is John Balitis. He is an attorney, an employment attorney, I should say, with Fenimore Craig. Good to see you again. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Tim.
All right. These system adjustments, these retirement system adjustments, who exactly is affected by these changes?
A wide variety of people, because it affects, the reforms affect four different plans in the state. The Arizona State Retirement System, which is the largest, the Correction Workers Retirement System, the Public Safety Retirement System, as well as the Elected Officials Retirement System. So you've got state and local government employees, firefighters, police officers, correction officers, and elected officials, which include judiciary members.
Okay, explain the adjustments. What
are
we looking at?
There is a wide variety of adjustments. They range anywhere from adjusting contribution rates to cost of living adjustments to caps on certain enhanced programs. The core adjustments really, though, relate to contribution rates. And this is true both on an individual level and on a global level. For example, right now, a police officer contributes about 7.5% of his or her wages to their pension fund. Over the next 5 years, under the reforms, that's going to creep up. That's going to inch up to about 11.5%. Same is true on the global level with respect to contribution rates. Right now, in the Arizona State Retirement System, you have a 50-50 ratio between the public employer contributing and the individual. Under the reforms next month, that'll start to change. The employee now is going to be contributing 53%. The public employer will contribute 47%. All these types of changes are designed to promote the financial health of the plans and the systems.
What about double dipping? That was addressed as well.
Double dipping is a practice that has developed over the years, in large part in the teaching segment, and it involves, but you know, it covers all plans, but it involves situations in which an individual will retire, start collecting a pension, but then will go back to work, sometimes through employment with another agency that then gets paid around the back. And there is a measure within the reforms that puts restrictions on double dipping. One of the things that is going to become new in that scenario is the employee, if they go back to work and continue to collect pension benefits, will then have to start contributing to the plan again. Currently, in the double dipping scenario, that doesn't happen.
Interesting. All right, you mentioned enhanced programs, things like what, lump sum payments, these sorts of things, that is adjusted as well?
There's a program for firefighters and police officers, for example, the Deferred Retirement Opportunity Program, the DROP program, mm-hmm. which in its current form allows a police officer or a firefighter to defer their retirement for 5 years. And during this five-year period, they are no longer contributing to the enhanced program, which results in a lump sum payment at the end of the five-year period in addition to the regular pension payment that they would receive. These payments are large in some instances, $250,000 at the end of this drop period. Some of the reforms will address this and then will require contributions during the drop, during the five-year deferral period, which aren't mm-hmm. required now. Mm-hmm. Once again, trying to promote the financial stability of the plan and infuse some more money into the trusts and the plans.
And that really is the reason these adjustments are necessary, correct? Talked about these retirement systems and the ratio of assets to liabilities, where it has been what it is right now.
Well, these retirement systems have been around since the 1950s when they were first created. And in the mid to late 90s, they were flush. They were, their assets exceeded their obligations by maybe 10, 15, 20%. Now, and this is really the catalyst for all of these reforms, the asset to obligation ratio, meaning whether your assets can cover your current obligations, is fluctuating, depending on which of these four plans you look at, somewhere between 66 and 80%. By industry standards, a public retirement plan is considered healthy if those assets could support 80 to 100% of the current obligations. So statistically, the plans, you know, aren't really currently sustainable if you look at the statistics.
And yet, you said that in times past, these programs, these systems were flush. Does that not suggest that when the good times come back again, which I think we all hope they do, this whole situation becomes more viable?
Well, absolutely. We're worried about the sustainability of the plans now. When the economy turns around, we won't be in an asset contraction mode anymore, hopefully. We'll be in an asset growth mode. And just like your investments and mine, the plan assets will grow, and we will have a completely different situation. But that doesn't alleviate the need at this point to address what's going on with the plans.
And in addressing what's going on, a lot of folks are looking at the Constitution, which, and I'll read it again, public retirement benefits shall not be diminished or impaired. Benefits, diminished, impaired, seems rather clear. Not necessarily?
Well, what you're reading from is Article 29 in the Arizona State Constitution. And this article was passed in 1998 as a referendum. It was Proposition 100 back then. And when it was passed, the plans were flush. And the reason it was passed to protect benefit rights was because there was concern that these funds, these public retirement funds, could be raided to support other programs or create new programs. And the legislature wanted to protect them. They weren't thinking down the road at the time about the situation we're in now, which is exactly the opposite. So these terms, benefit, diminish, impair, they're not defined anywhere in the article. People weren't worried about defining them with the idea that at some point we're going to have to cut back on benefits. And so we have no definitions for those terms. And that opens up the avenue for a lot of judicial discretion, if and when a lawsuit is filed to challenge the reforms, to interpret the terms and see how they play out.
If and when a lawsuit is filed, who hears the lawsuit?
Well, that's actually, Ted, an excellent question, because depending on what's at issue in the lawsuit, say, for example, the elected officials' retirement plan elements and the reforms are at issue. That would affect many sitting judges, Superior Court judges, judges on the Court of Appeals, Supreme Court judges, all of whom have a personal interest in the outcome of the dispute. We have a rule that takes into account the possibility that this will happen. Periodically, disputes will arise that could impact a judge personally. The rule is called the rule of necessity. And what the rule of necessity basically stands for is the proposition that in this situation, where you have a dispute that could affect sitting judges personally, the outcome could, it gets bumped up to the Arizona Supreme Court with the thinking that the best and the brightest and the most publicly visible and accountable judges in the state would hear it and decide it. So, depending on what's at issue in the lawsuit will depend on whether it goes to the Supreme Court or it stays at the trial court level.
And last question, this of course depending on whether or not the lawsuit is filed, but let's say it is filed, let's say parts of it succeed, not all of it, just parts of it succeed. Does that mean the entire system, the entire adjustments that were passed by the legislature, signed into law, the whole thing is down the tubes, or just that one thing that didn't go through?
The way it should work is this should be like an a la carte menu when this thing is challenged, if it ever is. Meaning, let's say the lawsuit is going to take into consideration 12 different reform elements, and six of them pass constitutional muster because they don't constitute an impairment or a diminishment of a benefit, and the rest do not, and they are invalidated. Those invalidated provisions then will not move forward as part of the reforms. The remaining ones, though, that pass the test should remain intact and stay in place.
Should. But not necessarily.
Well, that's the way the legislation is written.
Okay.
So we should not have a situation where if one element fails out of a dozen, the
right.
whole reform package goes away. That isn't the way it was contemplated.
All right. Very good. Good stuff. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Ted.